Hello, welcome to the class on E540 Advanced Electromagnetic Theory and Antennas. I am Professor Rakesh Singh Chatterjee. So in this class, we'll solve the Helmholtz-Webb equation. We have already derived Helmholtz-Webb equation in the previous class. We want to solve Helmholtz-Webb equation in cylindrical coordinates. So now this is the Helmholtz-Webb equation, Laplacian of electric field minus gamma I square, gamma I is the propagation constant, electric field equal to zero. So this is the equation we want to solve in cylindrical coordinate system. So now we can make a simplification of this Helmholtz-Webb equation when we consider a lossless medium. As I already told you before, lossless medium alpha is zero. Alpha is the real part of gamma, so gamma will simply turns out to be j beta. So in that case, you can simplify the Helmholtz-Webb equation as Laplacian of electric field plus beta square E is equal to 0. E is the electric field, beta is the phase constant. So now, we want to solve this in the cylindrical coordinate system. In the cylindrical coordinate system, electric field will have three components: E rho, E theta, E rho, E phi and E z. So these are the three components of electric field in the cylindrical coordinate system. E rho and E phi we are not interested in solving. So most of the time we are interested in solving E z or I z. So the wave equation for E z and I z would be Laplacian of E z or I z plus beta square E z or I z is equal to 0. So we want to solve such kind of wave equation. Laplacian of electric field plus beta square electric field equal to 0, or Laplacian of magnetic field plus beta square magnetic field equal to 0, where electric field and magnetic field we are interested in the EZ and IZ component. So the question is, why are we interested in the EZ component or IZ component of the electric field and magnetic field? That is because most of the time we discuss about waves which are called TEZ waves or TMZ waves. So the waves we consider is usually either T or TM waves. Then we are interested in TZ or TMZ waves. So here in such kind of waves, TZ and TMZ waves, we actually consider wave propagation along the Z axis. So along the Z axis, wave will be propagating, and we are interested in, let's say, TE means what? TE means it's a short form of transverse electric. Transverse electric means electric field is perpendicular to the direction of propagation of the wave, which is Z. Or TMZ means transverse magnetic, which means wave is propagating along the Z axis, but we are interested in the transverse magnetic. That means magnetic field is perpendicular to the direction of propagation. In other words, electric field and magnetic field will not have components along the Z axis for TZ and TMZ waves respectively. We can also illustrate this using a proper diagram. Let's say we have XYZ axis. So we have XYZ axis. So XYZ axis we have. So here you can draw a cylinder because we are interested in the cylindrical coordinate system. Let's say if you consider what kind of wave, TEZ waves, transverse electric wave. So electric field will not have components along the Z axis. So here electric field will have only rho and phi components. So that means electric field will confine in this plane here, rho and phi plane. It will not have any Z components. So these are TEZ waves. We can also have TMZ waves similarly. So now we are interested in solving wave equation in cylindrical coordinate system for TEZ and TMZ waves. So that's why we need to solve wave equation of the form Laplacian of Ez or Iz plus beta square Ez or Iz equal to 0. So we want to solve this equation. So this is the wave equation we are considering now. So now you know the Laplacian in general curvilinear coordinates by now. We have already spent a lot of time on this. And the expression for Laplacian in the general curvilinear coordinate system is 1 by S1, S2, S3. Then this first term here, second term here, third term here. We know what are these terms now. So let's say I want to write the Laplacian in the cylindrical coordinate system. What I need to do is I need to know what are the scale factors S1, S2, S3, A1, A2, A3. These are the coordinates for the cylindrical coordinate system. So I need to know that for the cylindrical coordinate system. Scale factor for the cylindrical coordinate system was 1 rho 1. For cylindrical coordinate system, scale factors was 1 rho 1. So S1 is 1, S2 is rho, and S3 is 1. And coordinates A1, A2, A3 for the cylindrical coordinate system was rho, phi, and z. So now you just substitute that in this Laplacian equation and plug it into the wave equation. So the wave equation turns out to be like this. Okay, so we just put the Laplacian in the cylindrical coordinate system, then Ez of Laplacian of Ez plus beta square Ez equal to 0 turns out to be this. So now I want to simplify this further. So look at this first term here. First term here, we have been partial derivative with respect to rho of this term here. So we'll get two terms here. So it will be this term and this term. First term has been simplified to this term and this term. So the wave equation is now like this. We can simplify this wave equation, we can solve it. That's what we are trying to do in this class. So now first thing you need to notice is Ez here. So in the spherical coordinates we have rho, phi and z. Ez will be dependent on rho, phi and z variables. So now can we somehow simplify the dependence of Ez on rho, phi and z? Assume that dependence of Ez on rho, phi and z are independent. They are separated. No? That's what the method of separation of variable means. We can express in that case Ez can be as product of three functions rho, R, phi, capital phi and capital z, where capital R is a function of rho, capital phi is a function of phi and capital z is a function of z. So this is by applying the method of separation of variables. I can replace Ez as product of rho, capital phi and capital z in the wave equation. So when we do that, you know that when I do partial derivative of Ez with respect to rho, only R is the function which is dependent on rho. These are independent of rho, so we can take it outside. Phi z can be taken outside. Similarly here also, when I do partial derivative with respect to phi, only this capital phi is dependent on phi, so r and z can be taken outside. We have done that here. Similarly, when I do partial derivative of Ez with respect to z, only capital z is dependent on z, so I do partial derivative of capital z with respect to z. It's a double derivative here. R and phi are independent of z, so you can take it outside. And we also have beta square plus beta square. Ez, Ez is replaced by R, capital phi, capital z. So now this is the wave equation we have here. We can further simplify this wave equation by dividing by 1 by R, capital phi, capital z on both sides. So in that case, what we are getting is this. This is the wave equation after dividing the previous wave equation by capital R, capital phi and capital z. So now look at this wave equation. This last term is totally dependent on z variable, and on the right hand side we have a constant. So we can equate this term here to another constant, which is minus beta z square. In that case we will replace this term by minus beta z square. Beta z is a constant, so we have the simplified wave equation. Now replace this term by minus beta z square. So now we can further simplify. You see, we want to solve the wave equation, simplify by simplifying it. So we can multiply by rho square in both sides. This is what we get after multiplying by rho square in both sides of the previous equation of the wave. So now look at this term here. This term here is totally dependent on phi, and we have a zero here in the right hand side. I can equate this term to another constant. We call it minus m square. So we'll replace this by minus m square. So m is a constant. In that case, the equation reduced to this. So now we can notice that this term here can again be denoted by another variable which is dependent on rho, let's say beta rho. Beta rho square is equal to beta square minus beta z square. In that case, the wave equation reduced to this. So now, one more observation I can make now is we have a capital R here in the denominator here. So if I multiply by R to this equation, I can simplify this wave equation, and what I am getting is surprisingly one of the very famous equation, which is called Bessel's differential equation. So you must have learned about the Bessel's differential equation in your undergraduate studies. How do we solve it? We solve it by power series expansion method. We will find the solution of this Bessel differential equation so that we can get the expression for the wave for the Helmholtz wave equation in the cylindrical coordinate system. So there are two possible solutions for the Bessel's differential equation. The first one we'll consider it. In the first one, this Bessel equation can be this Bessel differential equation has a solution of capital R as combination of Jm and Ym. What is Jm? Jm is the Bessel's function of first kind. Ym is the Bessel's function of second kind. So we'll see what is the expression for Jm and Ym. So what is Jm? Bessel's function of first kind. Jm can be expressed in infinite series expansion and summation n going from 0 to infinity minus 1 to 4 n beta rho divided by 2 to the power 2 n plus m divided by n factorial n plus m factorial. So this is the infinite series expansion of Bessel's function of first kind for mth order. So this is the mth order Bessel's function of first kind. We will also have another expression for the Bessel's function of second kind, ym. Ym can be expressed as jm beta rho cosine of m pi minus j minus m beta rho divided by sine of m pi. This is the Bessel function of first kind. We also have Bessel function of first kind, but here the order is minus m. So if I want to get the expression for Bessel function of first kind with order minus m, just replace m here in this infinite series expansion by minus m. And this is the expression we are getting here. So we have the expression for the ym now. We also have the expression for jm. So we know what are these Bessel function of first kind and second kind. Bessel's function of second kind is also called as Weber function or Neumann function. That's another name for the Bessel function of second kind. Anyway, let us try to understand this Bessel function of first kind by considering different orders. So that's what we are going to see. We want to make you familiarize with the Bessel function so that, you know, when I say Bessel function, you should have an idea what is the Bessel function. So for that, I need to consider Bessel function of first kind first. We'll consider the zero order and first order first. This is the infinite series expansion for the Bessel function of first kind for zero order. M was the order of the Bessel function. So when I replace M is equal to zero in the infinite series expansion of the Bessel function of first kind, what I'm getting is something like this. Summation n going from 0 to infinity minus 1 to the power n x by 2 to the power 2n divided by n factorial into n factorial. So now you put n is equal to 0, you get 1. N is equal to 1, you get minus x squared by 2 squared 1 factorial whole square plus and so on. You can give the values of n 0, 1, 2, 3 and we'll have an infinite series expansion here. So now the first thing to be noticed here is that this Bessel's function of first kind of zero order when x is equal to 0 turns out to be 1. Which trigonometric function has a value of 1 when argument is 0? So you can guess it. So it's a cosine function. Cos of 0 is 1. So this function is very much like a cosine function. We can even plot this in MATLAB. There's a command for plotting this Bessel function. So you can simply plot it. This is what we are seeing here. The plot of the Bessel's function with respect to, so let's say I want to plot J0x with respect to x. This is a solid line here you are seeing here. So the first observation is that this function is like a cosine function because when the argument is 0, this function is giving a value of 1. So it's like a cosine function. So let's look at the, so it's like a cosine function. Let's look at the J1. J1 is the Bessel's function of first kind of first order. So in the infinite series expansion for Jm, I can just put m is equal to 1 and what I'm getting is summation n going from 0 to infinity minus 1 to the power n x by 2 to the power 2n plus 1 divided by n factorial into n plus 1 factorial. So now when I put n is equal to 0, then what I'm getting is x by 2. When I put n is equal to 1, what I'm getting is minus x cubed divided by 2 to the power cube, 1 factorial, 2 factorial, plus and so on. So this is the infinite series expansion. What you can observe here is that when x is equal to 0, this Bessel function of first kind of order 1 is giving me a 0. So which trigonometric function gives you 0 when argument is 0? That is your sine function. So J1x is plotted here. It looks like a sine function. But we see that there is some difference between this J0x and J1x with cos of x and sine of x. What is the difference? First thing is that the zeros, the zero crossings are not at the same distance. So the zero crossings are not regularly spaced, keeps on changing. That's the first difference we are observing with the Bessel's function of first kind, zero order, and first order with the cosine function and sine function. First difference is that zero crossings are not regularly spaced. Second observation is that look at the amplitude of the J0x and J1x, peak amplitude keeps on decreasing. For the sine and cosine function, peak amplitude is always fixed. So these are the two major differences. So your Bessel's function of order 0 is like cosine function, and Bessel's function of first order is like sine function, with the difference that zeros are not regularly spaced and amplitude of the peak of the functions are decreasing with distance. So what we have is J2x here. This is JmX with respect to x. This is the plot we have for the Bessel's function of zero order, first order, and second order. So what we observe here is that all these functions are having a finite value when x is tending to zero. So that's one of the major observation. Your Bessel's function of first kind of mth order is finite for rho is tending to zero. Unlike this Bessel's function of first kind, if you plot the Bessel's function of second kind, y, what we will observe is that it will always start from minus infinity. That means when rho is tending to infinity, zero, the value of this Bessel's function of second kind always gives me a value of minus infinity. So it has a finite value for rho is tending to zero. So we'll be using this later on. So this property will give me some idea of what kind of wave will be there in the cylindrical waveguide later on. That's why. So we can also look at the behavior of this J and Y when rho is very much greater than 1. Rho is very large, or large argument of the rho. So J M is approximated as square root of 2 by pi beta rho cosine of beta rho minus m pi by 2 minus pi by 4. This is the approximation of the Bessel's function of first kind of any order when the argument is very large. The argument is very large, r is very much greater than 1. So in that case, so one thing to be noticed here is that you see that this wave is amplitude is varying as 1 by square root of rho. So that was the signature of the cylindrical waves when we discussed about the cylindrical waves in an eclectic way. We also have cosine of beta rho. This will give me the phase of the wave due to motion along the rho direction. You can also express ym for the large value of argument rho. Rho is very large. So in that case, we have this expression here, approximation. Square root of 2 by pi beta rho sine of beta rho minus m pi by 2 minus pi by 4. So now you can see the signature of the cylindrical wave is still valid here. You have 1 by square root of rho, you have sine of beta rho. So this is the phase due to wave motion along the rho direction. And usually these expressions are used for bounded medium like circular waveguide. Let's say you want to find the fields inside a circular waveguide. It's a bounded medium because your wave is bounded by the circular cylinder, metallic cylinder. So now this JM and YM are the basic building blocks for standing cylindrical waves, not for propagating, it's for standing cylindrical waves. Because sine and cosines are usually sine and cosine here are usually for standing waves. So JM and YM are the basic building block for standing cylindrical waves. And you also noted that YM was tending to minus infinity when rho is tending to zero. So such kind of fill is not possible inside a circular waveguide. You cannot have an infinite fill at the cylindrical axis of the circular waveguide. So this solution is not possible for circular waveguide. We'll see that later on. Okay, what is the second solution? First solution was Bessel function of first kind and second kind. Second solution we also have for the Bessel differential equation is in terms of Hankel function of first kind and second kind. We can express capital R, which is a function of beta rho, rho as this is the Bessel function of first kind, this is Bessel and not Bessel function, Hankel's function of first kind and Hankel's function of second kind, where A2 and B2 are any arbitrary constant. So R, which is a function of rho, can be expressed as combination of Bessel's function of first kind and second kind. So now, what are this Bessel's function of first kind and second kind? Let's see. They can be expressed in terms of Bessel's function of first kind and second kind. So we can express this Hankel's function of first kind and second kind as Bessel's function of second kind and first kind. So let's say I want to represent this Hankel's function of first kind. So we have a 1 here is a first kind. We can express this as Jm beta rho rho plus Jym beta rho rho. So looking at this expression, this looks like, you know, exponential of J beta rho rho, which is cosine of beta rho rho plus J sine of beta rho rho. But this exponential of J beta rho rho was a propagating wave along the negative rho direction. So basically, Sm1, Hankel's function of first kind, actually represent propagating wave, unlike the Bessel's function of first kind and second kind was a standing wave. So Sm1 is an ingoing wave in the negative rho direction. Similarly, you can also represent Sm2 as Jm beta rho rho minus Jym beta rho rho, which is similar to exponential of minus J beta rho rho, which is cosine of beta rho rho minus J sine of beta rho rho. This kind of wave is a positive wave which is propagating along the positive rho direction. So this Hankel function of second kind is a wave which is an outgoing wave along the positive rho direction. So this Bessel functions of first kind and second kind gives you standing cylindrical wave, but Hankel's function of first kind and second kind gives you the propagating waves. We can also observe it from the last argument approximation of this Hankel function of first kind and second kind. For the last value of rho, Hankel's function of first kind can be approximated as square root of minus 2j divided by pi beta rho rho exponential j beta rho rho minus m pi by 2. So now, what do you see here? You have exponential j beta rho rho. This is a wave which is going in negative rho direction. And another thing is that you also see that square root of 1 by rho is there. So this is signature of cylindrical wave. And this is an ingoing wave along the negative rho direction. Similarly, you can also express Hankel's function of second kind for large argument when argument is very large as square root of 2j divided by pi beta rho rho exponential minus j beta rho rho plus m pi by 2. So now when you have exponential minus j beta rho rho, it means that this wave is moving in the positive rho direction. So this is an ingoing, outgoing wave along the positive rho direction. You can also observe that all the waves which is represented by Hankel's function of first kind and second kind for large argument was decaying as 1 by rho, which is a signature for the cylindrical wave. And the phase of oscillation is also decided by m here. So this m will also give you phase of oscillation. So this Sm1 and Sm2 are the basic building block for propagating cylindrical waves. Jm and Ym are the basic building block for standing cylindrical waves. Sm1 and Sm2 are the basic building blocks for propagating cylindrical waves. So we need to solve two more equations, one for the phi, so 1 by phi, del square phi by del phi square, there should be a phi here, equal to minus m square, so z should be phi here. So now this will also have similarly two possible solutions. One for periodic wave, one for the propagating wave. For the periodic waves, it will have solution of the form C1 cosine of M phi plus D1 sine of M phi. So cosine and sine functions are periodic waves. We can also have propagating wave solution to that. In that case, it will become C2 exponential minus Jm phi plus D2 exponential Jm phi. So C1, D1, C2, D2 are any arbitrary constant. And we have another equation also we need to solve for z, 1 by capital Z, del square capital Z by del Z square is equal to minus beta Z square. Obviously, this will also have two possible solutions. One for the standing waves, for the standing wave, this will be sine and cosine. So, E1 cos of beta Z, Z plus F1 sine beta Z, Z. This for the standing waves. For the propagating wave, obviously, we'll have exponential functions. E2 exponential minus j beta z z. So there should be a z here. Then exponential j beta z z. There should also be a z here. E1, F1, E2, F2 are any arbitrary constants. So we have all the solutions of the wave equation in the cylindrical coordinate system. Let us try to finally put into typical solution of cylindrical waves propagating along the z axis. Let's say this is xyz. This is the cylinder. Let's assume that it is propagating along the z direction. And we are interested in finding TMZ modes. Now, TMZ modes. So, magnetic field is transverse to the z direction. There is direction of wave propagation. So, magnetic field will be confined in the rho phi plane. But in that case, magnetic field will not have any z component. EZ will be zero. EZ will be zero, but EZ will still have value which is non-zero along the z direction. So Iz still has a component along the z direction. Iz doesn't have any component along the z direction, but Ez has a component along the z direction. So I can always solve the wave equation for Ez in this case. Ez is non-zero. If we have Tz modes here, we can solve Iz. Iz will not be zero, Ez will be zero. Just opposite case. So for Tmz modes, Ez is not zero, so I can solve the wave equation for Ez, that was Laplacian of Ez plus beta square Ez equal to 0. That was the wave equation we have solved, and we have got the solution for the wave for both propagating and standing waves. So let's say I want to have a propagating wave inside this cylinder. So let's say this is an infinite cylinder. I want to have a propagating wave inside this cylinder. In that case, what should be the solution? Obviously, that solution Ez will be product of capital R, capital phi and capital Z. What is the capital R and capital phi and capital Z for this propagating wave inside the cylinder? This is the expression we have here. This for the R, there is a double plus here, it should be removed. So this capital R, this is capital phi and capital Z here. Look at this expression for capital Z. So we have exponential minus J beta Z, Z, exponential plus J beta Z, Z. So we have a wave propagating along positive and negative Z direction. So we're propagating along the z direction is satisfied from here. This solution gives me a wave which is periodic in nature in the phi. Then finally, let's look at the wave here. Since we are considering propagating inside the cylinder, we should actually have a Jm and Ym. So Jm, Ym, A1, Jm, beta rho, rho plus B1, Ym, beta rho, rho. Why I am cutting this one is because we have observed that Ym was having a value of infinity, minus infinity at rho is equal to 0. So this is not a possible solution. We cannot have infinite field at the cylindrical axis. So this is cut out now. So this is the expression you have for the propagating cylindrical waves inside a cylinder. Let's say I want to have wave propagation outside the cylinder also. In that case, the solution would be again, expressed as a product of R, capital phi and capital Z, and the expression now will be little bit different. So now, this portion of the wave, this is called capital Z, will give me propagating wave along the positive and negative Z axis. We have a Z here. We have a Z here. So this will give me periodic waves along the phi direction. Look at this expression here. This expression is different now. Since we are having wave for the unbounded medium outside the cylinder also, will replace all the Jm and Ym by Ym1 and Ym2. We have a propagating wave now outside the cylinder. So, and you know that if the wave is, see, this one was the wave propagating along the negative rho axis, and this one was wave propagating along the positive rho axis. So this is not possible. Source is here and wave is coming towards the source is not possible. You have a source here, wave should move out like this. So that's why we have Xm2 here. So these are some of the possible waves propagating inside cylinder or outside the cylinder, or let's say cylindrical waves we can consider for TMZ modes. We can even consider it for TZ mode also, but you can similarly analyze it like this. So we have solved the wave equation, Helmholtz-Welch equation for in the cylindrical coordinates, and we got the cylindrical waves. So that's the end of this class. Hope to see you in the next class. Thank you.